voice actor Alan Rickman. It all started during the making of Robin Hood, and rumor has it that Rickman's Sheriff of Nottingham was a little too good to Costner's Robin. So good, in fact, that much of Rickman's work was left on the cutting room floor. Now, Alan Rickman will join me in a minute, but first, here is a scene that did make it to the screen.
All right, then. Fine, raise the bounty on his head. 25,000 crowns.
Begging your pardon, sir, it won't do no good. How much you raise it?
Really, Scribe, and why is that?
Because, sire, the poor, you see, he gives them what he takes, so, well, sire, they love him.
Just a minute. Robin Hood steals money from my pocket, forcing me to hurt the public. And they love him for it?
Yes.
Cancel the kitchen scraps for lepers and orphans. No more merciful beheading. And call off Christmas.
Ooh, scary. The Sheriff of Nottingham, Alan Rickman, from last year's Robin Hood. Alan Rickman joins me from Toronto now. How are you?
Very well, thank you. How are you?
Well, delighted to talk to you. I have to say that I was quite shameless in my attempts to get you into the studio in London when I was there a couple of months ago. I begged Thelma Holt. I begged everybody. And yet, and still, you refused me. But now I've got you. I'm glad.
Well, it was tough doing that play and,
Tango at the end of winter.
It was hard.
I came to see it.
And?
I thought it was, well, you worked very hard.
Shall I leave now?
No, you shouldn't. But I have to say, a friend of mine just had a movie at the Vancouver Film Festival, and he said to me before we went in, he said, if you tell me this film is interesting, I'll kill you. Anyway, let's talk about the new one.
Let's talk about Tango for a minute.
Oh, all right. Oh.
Well, I want to know why you didn't have a good time.
I didn't say that I didn't have a good time.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't say that. I just said I thought you worked very hard. I thought, maybe I have a problem with acting students crawling all over the stage, you see. I thought you were splendid, of course, but then, as I already said to Thelma Holt, that you could thread a needle and you would be interesting on screen or on the stage, which is a bit gushy, but there you are.
It required the audience to come with a very open frame of mind, and I think the trouble is a lot of people really loved it and came back 4 and 5 times, and I was just always interested in what anybody's reaction was, because they were always so different, and I think it was to do with the level at which people came in with expectations of what the word play means.
Yes.
And I wish that there'd been a sign up outside saying, think how you respond to a song or a picture, and then come in.
Do you think that it had a particularly, it does have a particularly Japanese sensibility, and I wonder if in the translation that the English-speaking public or the Western audience doesn't get it in the same way. And if you do come a few times to see such a production, that you are much more sensitized to it.
I'm not sure about this thing about particularly Japanese sensibilities. It's the first modern Japanese play that I think has ever been done in mm-hmm. England or in the West. So something new was happening there. I dare say all sorts of strange things happened the first time Chekhov was done in England.
I dare say.
Or anywhere else. No, I don't think you can draw any general rules. I think it depends what frame of mind you go to the theatre in and whether you're open enough and how much baggage you're carrying around with you.
Oh, dear. I do feel rested now. I already said this, a sweet, sweet guy. And, you haven't had a lot of parts, and I think it's one of the reasons that I was a little nervous about talking to you, because your reputation seems to have developed all along the lines of being kind of a scary guy.
Well, only because of a couple of movies that made a lot of money, which if you set 2 movies that made a lot of money against however many years it is in the British theatre.
Mm-hmm.
It's a kind of imbalance to me, but there you go. That's what happens when 2 films get a lot of publicity.
Sure, and I say that your life has dramatically changed, your work life, that is, since the sheriff of Nottingham role, has this done something to your career that you didn't think would happen?
I don't know. I really don't know. I mean, I was in England, and as soon as all of that, whatever that was, happened, I was basically into a play, and glad of it, because it was kind of back to basics, and so all of the other stuff was going on while I was trying to come to grips with what this play was about, and the kind of 8 times the weakness of it. You know, Robin Hood is like an explosion going off, and the dust will settle.
You can only hope, I guess, huh?
It will. Yeah, it will, because it does. There'll be another explosion in 6 months.
From what now?
Some other movie.
Well, now, so are you going to be get your guard up in any way about the roles that you take?
Well, I'm careful, but it has to interest me. Otherwise, I will be bad. It's that simple.
When have you ever been bad?
Oh, often.
Oh, tell me when.
Oh, God, yes.
Tell me the worst you've ever done.
I think the last thing I did had moments of such terribleness in it that you shrivel in embarrassment. Everything you do, actually, I'm sure every actor would say the same. I mean, I have to sit here and listen to that excerpt from Truly Madly Deeply and think, how was I allowed to get away with that?
In particular, what is it that you thought you were getting away with in that scene?
Never, actually. Unfortunately, especially, that's why I don't ever go and watch rushes, because what you see up on a screen is not remotely what you think you're doing. My voice is not... The voice you hear is not the one I hear. So that always comes as a shock for a start. And things like, you know, critics saying he spoke in a hardly audibly. I think I can be heard, but clearly one can't. So there's a huge kind of gap between your own imagination and what's actually going across. And every time you see yourself on screen, it's a big shock to see how far you are away from what you even thought you were doing.
Well, what did you think in Truly Madly Deeply that you were doing that was so completely different than what I saw? Give me just one small example.
It's the tone of voice. You think, you know, you think, God, does anybody speak that slowly? Is it physically possible? And I don't hear that. So that always comes as a shock. You think you're just basically sitting in my head. Somebody tell this actor to get on with it.
Have you ever done any radio? Radio plays, I guess.
Oh, loads, yeah. Good fun. You don't have to learn the lines, you don't have to get dressed up.
That's the thing, you don't have to get dressed up. I am sitting here in a bride suit, though, just to amuse myself. Do you still draw at all? Because, as I understand it, you were a graphic artist. So you're
any
good at that?
I don't as much as I should. It's it's like any other muscle. If you have or you're blessed with, you should keep it fit, and I don't as much as I ought to.
So do you fancy that in your dotage you're going to get out the old watercolor?
I think so. I think I will.
Wonderful thought, isn't it?